morning. Welcome to Grace Point. If you're visiting with us, welcome. Fill out a guest card. We'd love to meet you after church. Josh and I will be out in the foyer at the high top. Just a couple announcements. Your bulletin has several things in there. Next week is a busy week for us. We have a few things going on. One is our kids' Christmas program, so don't forget about that. Invite your family, invite your friends. Everybody always loves to see the kids and their talents. And it's always a good time. Also, we have two events that day, a family Christmas party and the men's get-together. So those are meant to be together, so moms and grandmas and things can come to the church with the kids. We're going to have dinner, games and crafts, and just have a good time. And the men are going to be at Belly Buster's from 4 to 7 hanging out and doing their thing. So I says family, but men, you are still okay to go. Us wives will not get angry if you are at the men's event. Promise. Okay, so we're going to get started. Paul and Shirley, if you want to come up.
The top of this paper says, share your traditions during Advent. And my family, I only had one daughter, and she lived out of town. So every Christmas we went and did the Christmas Eve service with them. And that's when the children opened up their gifts. That way they knew what was from us and what was from under the tree. I don't like to say Santa Claus. But under the tree. And then the next morning, she would always have her casserole made, that we would have breakfast together, and the children would open their gifts. Then we had our big dinner. I'm grateful that she always cooks the meals now. I don't have to do that. But things are changing now. They've moved closer to home. And the children are going into their teen years. And I miss the little children, but pray that they will continue what they have been taught as children.
For our family, we get together and have a really good meal. We go out to my granddaughter's place out there, and they have a large building out back, and it's all furniture. So on Thanksgiving Day, we had at least 30 of us there, as far as all the kids and the grandkids. On Christmas, on 23rd here, we'll be getting together again out there, and we'll have the little ones will have changed gifts, and the others, and the older ones will play games until we're ready to eat. So then we give thanks to God and go ahead about our meals. So we really are blessed in having a family. We lost one baby this year, so he'll be missing at the table. But anyway, we'll have a blessed time and thank Jesus for today.
I forgot to mention too, we always had a birthday cake and sang that was our dessert for dinner. We sang a happy birthday to Jesus. Well, this is the second day of Advent, second Sunday of Advent, and we think about the coming of Jesus as we light the candle of peace. Had his shot this week and he couldn't see the wick. It's coming back then. Jesus Christ is our peace. He is the Prince of Peace. Christ comes to bring justice, wholeness, and harmony to every relationship throughout all creation. He wants us to continually grant peace in every situation. Fire burns, it hurts, it can destroy. Fire also gives warmth and light. The coming of Christ is both a day of judgment and a day of promise. Two candles are flickering brightly. Help us remember that the coming of Christ has many meanings. In Psalms 85, verses 10 and 11, we read, steadfast love and faithfulness will meet. Righteousness and peace will kiss each other. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. The first two candles are lit. Faithfulness will spring up from the ground, and righteousness will look down from the sky. May the Lord guide our feet into the way of his peace. Let us pray. Dear God, we have much to do, and we are not sure we will be ready for the day of your coming. In Advent's light, help us to see what is important, to be who you want us to be, and do what you want us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just real briefly, I'll mention the men's fellowship for next Sunday. I'm glad Rachel brought it up. Counted out there, we are at 26, I believe, which is awesome. If you know anybody that's interested, they do not have to come to church. Invite a friend, bring a friend, right on there, plus two, plus three, however many people. It's going to be great to have that many men together. We'll have a good time. Really looking forward to it. So next Sunday, 4 to 7. Scriptures that I want to share this morning talk about joy. Obviously, we're into the season of that we celebrate peace, love, joy. We celebrate the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus. But do we always show that joy, that love? Joy is the easiest one for everyone to see. If you have a peace in your life, if you have the love of the Lord in your life, that joy should shine out of you. The scripture I want to share is Romans chapter 15, verse 13. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that the power of the Holy Spirit, through the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. We as believers should be filled with joy and peace, and through the power of God's Holy Spirit, we have much hope. That's our promise. Proverbs 17:22 says, a joyful heart is good medicine, but a crushed spirit dries up the bones. So in Romans we read of the peace and the joy that we have in the Lord, and Proverbs says that being joyful or merry in our hearts is good medicine for us. But it also clearly states that the lost, those that do not have the joy of the Lord, have a crushed or broken spirit. They have dried bones. They are dead inside. I remember that feeling. Not a feeling that I want anybody to have. That emptiness, that dried up, that dead inside. Can I have the ushers, please? As we go through our daily lives, especially at this time of year, it's not always easy to share and show that joy that's within us. We all have stress. Stress levels go up this time of year because we're dealing with so many people, work and family. Shopping is always a joy. It's within us for others to see that joy. It should shine out of us. Sam was talking this morning in Sunday school. We were talking about the Beatitudes and how we're supposed to behave, how we should let the Lord rule our lives, and how our behavior should reflect him. We say Jesus is the reason for the season, but do we take Jesus with us everywhere we go for others to see him? I pray that that's what we do as believers. I want to pray over the offering. Lord, Heavenly Father, we just pray that we allow the hope, the peace, and the joy that is a gift from you to be a gift to others. I pray, Lord, that we can be willing vessels to give the gift that you have given us freely to others as well. I pray that the joy of our salvation and our relationship with you shines through our faces so others can see everywhere that we go and that we share you with everyone that we meet. Lord, bless your people today. Lord, I ask you to bless this offering, this tithe, to further your kingdom, Lord, so we can share your joy with this world. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so lonely, meek and mild. New life, new hope, new joy he brings. Won't you listen to the angels sing? I'm singing glory. Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so lonely, meek and mild. New life, new hope, new joy he brings. Won't you listen to the angels sing?
I'm singing
glory, glory,
and Joseph was his earthly father. Three wise men came from afar, and they were guided by a shining star to see King Jesus where he lay in a manger filled with hay.
And Jesus, Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so lonely, meek and mild.
Oh,
new life, new hope, new joy he brings. Won't you listen to the angels sing?
I'm singing
glory, glory, glory to the newborn King.
Oh,
Jesus,
oh,
Jesus, oh, what a wonderful child. Jesus, Jesus, so lonely, meek and mild. New life, new hope, new joy he brings. Won't you listen to the angels sing?
I'm singing
glory, glory, glory to the newborn King.
to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before hence, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all.
singing, I was thinking about that. The King of Kings, and you may be seated. Yes, sorry. The King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, he came to this earth for me and for you and so many, many, many years ago, but his name and his truth still stands forever. Amen? Amen? All right. So good to have you with us this morning. My name is Josh. I am the pastor here, and I do have another sweater on today, as you can see. Yeah, this is the Grinch one, so these are probably the last 2 weeks that you'll ever see me in a sweater, okay? Just being honest, but so we have been in this series, Christmas at the Movies. Last week we started with Home Alone. I hope you guys enjoyed that last week. Home Alone, basically, you might think, well, thank you for the one person. That's my wife back there clapping. I'm just kidding. But so Home Alone, last week you might be here thinking, well, how did this guy talk about Home Alone in church and kind of tie it into our life? Well, if you remember, just a quick recap, Home Alone was talking about how Kevin loved being alone at times. But truthfully, Scripture tells us that we need each other and we need to be unified together. And so that's kind of what we talked about last week. This week we are going to talk about the Grinch. You're a mean one. There we go. Yeah, let's go. So But I do want to say, before we kind of dig into today's message, if you are a visitor with us, welcome. It's so awesome that you're here. If you're watching online, it's awesome that you're watching with us. Maybe type in the comments, a chat or whatever. Say hi, hello, you're mean, this is terrible, I don't know, whatever you want to do. And maybe the Lord will convict you after this message today. But in the next couple weeks, I want to kind of prep you guys. We love our kids, amen. We love all of our kids that are here and that are with us at our church. But we want to protect them. And so we're going to be kind of rolling out a new safety team and a new safety measure. So we're asking if you bring a child to kind of start signing in when you come in. We'll get more into details in the next couple weeks. But we just need to protect our kids, amen. So but just be watching for that. So this is week two, and I'm already getting hot in this thing, so if I start sweating profusely, I might need more water. But we are in week two, How the Grinch Stole Christmas. If you know, this is a Christmas classic. I mean, to me, all these movies are Christmas classics, but Dr. Seuss wrote How the Grinch Stole Christmas, and so that's what we're going to be talking about today. This movie that we're going to watch, though, is not the original. This was the 2000 version that was made by Jim Carrey, or Jim Carrey is in it, and we're going to be watching that today. But if you know the Grinch, which I'm pretty sure everybody in here knows the Grinch for the most part, but this is a story about someone who hates Christmas. He hates Christmas. He doesn't want anything to do from Christmas. But if you watch and you kind of start to see the Grinch's methods, you see that it comes from something that happened in his childhood, in his past. And as we watch these three scenes that I have for you today, I want you to understand, I don't care how Christmassy you are, there is a Grinch inside of all of us at times. I know, don't look shocked. There is a Grinch in all of us. You see, we all have the potential to allow hurts. We have the potential to allow the hang-ups from our past to isolate us, the things that have been done wrong to us. They might keep us from believing in Jesus, believing in God, and rob us from the joy that God wants to give us, all of us. So that's why it's actually important. Proverbs tells us in Proverbs 4:23, it says, above all else, guard your hearts. Guard your hearts, for it determines the course of your life. So today, as we watch the Grinch, and we're going to see his heart, we're going to see how maybe his heart might change. And also, not only just his heart, it's going to change some of the relationships that he has with people in the future and in the past. So while we enjoy this great movie, these couple scenes that I have for you today, I also believe that we're going to see a modern-day parable of what it looks like for someone's heart to be transformed. So Steve, if you want to cue that first scene that I have for us today. So you see, this movie, the main character is the Grinch, right? But I believe that's not just the main character in this movie. The most important character that we're going to talk about today, in my opinion, is Lucy Lou Who. Lucy, it's Cindy. Thank you. I'm sorry. Cindy. I don't know where I got Lucy. Thinking of peanuts over here. But her whole life, Cindy has been told about this bad man living on top of this mountain all by himself, that he's done these bad things. She's heard the stories about, like, how the Grinch, the worst stories of the things that this guy has done. She's heard it her whole life. But as we saw there, after her encounter with him, she decides it doesn't matter to her. She's going to befriend the Grinch. And so what happens is it starts the beginning of a life-changing friendship to this bad man. And we know the story, but I love Cindy Lou Who's character, and I love how she just doesn't care. She's going to be believing the best in anybody, believing the best in people. Cindy was relentless. She was not giving up to this character, the Grinch. She had the ability to see past the appearance of what he looked like, of how scary he was, of how the stories that she's heard all of her life, the appearance of the Grinch, the past stories, the labels that people put on this man, she had the ability to look past that. You know, what's fascinating to me, though, is all of us at some point in our life, maybe when we were younger, maybe when we were adults, maybe when we were older, but all of us have had labels placed on us, haven't we? A lot of us at times. We all know what it feels like to be on the outside looking in at some point in our life. And we know that some people might not really care about you. They might not really like you. And sometimes we also know, like the Grinch, we know what everybody thinks of us. And that's a bad place. It's no fun, is it? It's no fun to be in that situation. And if we spend much time in that situation and in that place, we begin to lose faith in people. We begin to lose faith in those that are around us. We begin to lose faith just in general with people. And that's why what Cindy does is so powerful, because she becomes the catalyst, in my opinion, of transformation in the Grinch's life, in this movie and in this story. But you know what's interesting? The Bible's pretty clear when it talks about our impact on other people's lives. In Proverbs chapter 11, verse 25, it tells us the generous will prosper. And listen to this, those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. Those who refresh others will themselves be refreshed. You see, church, there's something supernatural, refreshing, when we decide to be the champion for people in the margins, for those people that are the outcasts. There's something refreshing, like Proverbs tells us. I know it's easy to go with the crowds. It's easy to do what everybody else is doing and spend our lives trying to climb the social ladder or just to kind of fit in. But what if, like Cindy, we decided to be an encourager to someone today who needed a helping hand? What if we tried to do that? Proverbs 12, 25 also tells us, worry weighs a person down, but an encouraging word cheers a person up. You move on a couple chapters later in the book of Proverbs, it tells us a cheerful look brings joy to the heart. Good news makes for good health. So often what it takes to change someone's life in the small, simple things that we do. Saying hello to somebody that's maybe nobody's talking to. Giving a smile. Just being friendly to that person. You see, we can feel inadequate or unqualified to help someone. Maybe you felt that way. But according to what I just read to you in Proverbs, all it might take is that. Just an encouraging word. A look, a cheerful look to somebody. You know, Kelly kind of alluded to it today, and I was like, oh, here we go. He's going to preach the whole message. But he kind of alluded around this time of year, when you go shopping, when you go to the stores. You know, have you ever noticed around Christmas time and around the holidays where it's supposed to be the most wonderful time of the year, the happiest time of the year? You ever noticed that people don't really look happy sometimes? When you're out, you ever, anybody, or is it just me? Maybe it's me, but Rachel sometimes, and we'll go shopping at the mall, and sometimes I'll go with her, and when I don't want to go to my stores or something, I'll just kind of sit on a bench, and I'll people watch. Anybody ever people watch? It's awesome, okay? But it's awesome. There's some weird folks out there, and I'm not saying any of you, but it is so awesome. So what I'll do is I'll find a spot on a bench or, you know, a chair in the mall, and I'm watching people during this time of year, and nobody's smiling. Like, they come out and they're all in a hurry, it's so frantic, and there's just so much stuff going on. Nobody is cheerful. Nobody. Like, it's just crazy to me, because this is supposed to be the most wonderful time of the year, and nobody is joyful. You know, it seems like everybody's all stressed out to the max. We're all in a hurry. We're all trying to get the gift that keeps on giving, and we don't even know what that gift is. But the grind of everyday life seems to have taken a lot of people's joy, in my opinion. And you see, here's the other thing. It's not just in our shopping experiences either. too many churches and church folk and religious people walk around with no joy in their life. No joy. There's no joy on their face. There's no joy in their hearts. You see, what people first see on you, what their first impression of you, plays a critical part in someone else's walk with Jesus. I firmly believe that. We are called to model Christ inside and outside of the church. And so, like, sometimes I'll come in and I'll see people and, you know, they'll come up to me and they just don't seem happy and joyous. You know, when we first arrived here and there was one person that, man, I love him, love him, love him, love him. And Cindy's not here today with us, but she's probably watching online. But Ed Blontz was a man that would just smile at you. If you come through those doors, he'd come up, give you a hug, just talk to you. Always a smile on his face. Ed Blontz knew what it meant to have true joy in his life. Amen. And so Ed was always welcoming people and friendly to them. And so my prayer as a pastor is that we are a church that makes the stranger feel like family the minute they arrive here. That's my prayer for our church. You see, if you call yourself a follower of Jesus, and I know not everyone here might be a follower of Jesus, and I want to say thank you for being here. I think it's an honor and a privilege that you are investigating this guy Jesus with us. It's so awesome to have you here. But if you are a follower of Jesus Christ, you should have joy in your heart. You should have joy written all over your face. You should. Scripture is very clear about that. In fact, joy is a term that appears approximately 165 times in the King James translation of the Bible. It appears 182 times in another translation, and 218 times in the NIV. There is an author, his name is Navine Ritchie, and he's with a website called Unlocking the Bible. He shares this. In the English Standard Version of the Bible, the words joy, rejoice, or joyful appear a total of 430 times. 430 times, compared with happy or happiness, which only appear 10 times. Only 10. So let's take a look at what that word joy really means. We read in Scripture, we read in God's Word, that joy is a state of being. It differs from happiness, which may come and go. Happiness is usually measured by what? Your circumstances, right? My circumstances. Whereas joy has been measured by what we have been given. And as a Christian, you and I both know that we have been given something that cannot be taken away in Jesus Christ. We have joy because of the grace of Jesus that lives in us. We can hold on to joy. We can feel joyful. We can rejoice with praise no matter what your circumstance is, no matter what's going on in your life, because God is always near you. And so if he's always near me, then I need to have joy. Even in the bad days, we can joyfully focus on our Savior, Jesus Christ, on who he is in our life and who Jesus is to the world. No matter how down you might get, there's always joy to be found in the Lord. And the Scripture is full of these words, and I'm going to read a few of them to you. Psalm 16:11 tells us, "You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand." Nehemiah chapter 8, verse 10 said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, then send some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is holy to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." John chapter 15, 11, "I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be made complete." James 1, 2, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds." Acts 2, chapter 28, or verse 28, "You have made known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence." I'm not going to read all 400 verses to you today, but as you can hear, as you can see, it's pretty clear. You need to have joy. we need to have joy as followers of Christ. 2 Corinthians, I love this one, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor yet making rich, have nothing and yet possess everything. Psalm 74, but may all you who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. May those who long for your saving help always say, the Lord is great. So my challenge is, what if this Christmas, what if this holiday season, instead of fighting about stupid stuff that doesn't matter, stuff that doesn't matter to the kingdom of God, whether it's online or whether it's in person with somebody, what if the best gift that you gave to someone this Christmas is an encouraging word or a cheerful look? What if that's the best gift you can give? I think we all can do it. You see, because do we know anybody that's down right now? I know a few people. Do you know someone who's down, or maybe they feel like they're on that outside looking in platform? Maybe that is the first step in things changing with them, is you sharing your joy with them. Steve, if you could play that next. In the beginning of the movie, we find out how much the Grinch really hates Christmas, don't we? We find out that he hates Christmas so much that he's determined to ruin it for everyone else. He starts stealing all their stuff. He thinks that if I take their stuff, if I take their possessions, guess what? They're not going to be joyful. He decides to try to ruin it for everyone else. If the Grinch had any say in what he was doing, no one would celebrate Christmas because he's unhappy. So what does he do? He sneaks around into town. He begins to vandalize. He begins to steal everyone's Christmas decorations and food and things like that. This is often the case, too, with people who are hurting, isn't it? It's been said that hurt people hurt people. And that's never more true than in this story that we're watching today. You know, I'm willing to bet that there's been a time in your life where you've acted out from a place of hurt in your own life, too. Luke chapter 6, verse 45 says, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. This verse is so powerful, folks. It is so powerful because it lets us know where our actions and reactions in life come from. Where is the source of your joy? Where is the source of what you're going through? Just like the Grinch, when we encounter hurtful, defining moments in our life, we lock it away in our heart, and over time, if we do not deal with those hurts, if we do not deal with those pains, it can begin to reveal itself through our behaviors and through our attitudes. For some of you, it may be something like addiction, addiction to a drug or addiction to sex or alcohol. And while I am not claiming to be a doctor, I know many doctors, but while I am not claiming to be a doctor, so often you can trace back the triggers in your life to a hurtful experience in your past. You can. For others, it's a destructive pattern of relationships. Maybe your relationships are just always broken. Maybe because of issues from our own home as a child, you find yourself bouncing around from relationship to relationship, searching to fix a wrong that might have been done to you so many years ago. Maybe that's some of you. You're searching for something in a relationship that is not a healthy relationship. I don't know. For some of us, money is what we try to accomplish our happiness for. You know, it's amazing to me. I just told we had our council and our staff Christmas party last night, and I just was shocked when I read something last night that the Dodgers, any baseball fans here? I'm a huge baseball fan. The Dodgers just gave one man a $700 million contract for 10 years. $700 million. Here's what I know. That guy could have $1 billion, and that's not going to bring him true joy. True joy or true happiness. You could have all of the money that you want, and you still don't have joy. You see, because the Bible tells us that money cannot fill the huge void that you have in your life. Only Jesus Christ can. You don't believe me? Ecclesiastes 5:10 says, whoever loves money never has enough. Well, that's true, isn't it? Always trying to get more, right? More, more, more. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with their income. This, too, is meaningless. Book of Matthew, chapter 6, 24 says, we can't serve God and money. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. First Peter, don't be greedy for money. Whoever is greedy in the book of Proverbs troubles his household. Whoever is greedy for unjust gain troubles his own household, but he who hates bribes will live. Whatever it is that you are searching for, whatever it is that you're kind of like looking for, the book of Luke tells us that those behaviors come from the things that are stored in your own heart. So what's in your heart? How do you release those hurts that are ruining your life? How do you release those hurts? I've already said it. The answer is Jesus Christ. That's the only thing. He is the only person that will release those hurts that are in your life and in your heart. 1 Peter chapter 5, 7 tells us to cast all our anxiety on him because he cares for you. In the book of Psalms, it says, give your burdens to the Lord and he will take care of you. But my all-time favorite on this topic is Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 and 29. It says, then Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and carry heavy burdens. And what's he going to do? I will give you rest. I'm going to give you a break. Take my yoke upon you. Let me teach you, because I am humble and gentle at heart. And you will find rest for your souls. So in the midst of all the chaos, in the midst of everything and whatever you're running to grab, to put in your heart, that's not still giving you that joy, give it to God. Give it to Christ. You see, as long as you hold those hurts and the hang-ups from your past, as long as you do that, I believe that you will spiral out of control and hurt yourself. And I also believe that you might hurt people around you. But the Bible tells us that if we choose to, we can make an exchange with God by giving him our worries, by giving him our cares, by giving him our hurts and our pains. And we can pick up and rest in his grace. Amen? We can pick up and rest in him. I don't know about you, but to me, that sounds like a fantastic deal, right? I don't have to worry about it. It sounds like a great deal to me. I can go to Jesus Christ and give it to him. And I'm not trying to minimize those monumental moments that you have in your life. I am not trying to do that. The moments that have shaped you. I've had those as well. A lot of them in my life. And like me, I believe you might want to invest in some Christian counseling at times, because we all need to talk to somebody and we need some good Christian advice. But ultimately, I'm here to tell you this morning, true joy and peace can only be found when you hand over your hurts, when you hand over those hang-ups, when you hand over those pains to Jesus Christ and you just leave them with him. It's the only way. No doctor can help you. No person can help you. No spouse can help you. No child can help you. Jesus Christ is the only one. And so back to the story about the Grinch, though. As long as the Grinch believes that hurting other people will make him happy, guess what? He will continue to be disappointed. He's going to continue to go down the path that he's on. And in the next scene, we're going to see what happens when he finally realizes where true happiness and joy comes from. But before we do, have you ever noticed in your own life, in your own circle, someone who was so miserable that they couldn't allow anyone else around them to have a good time? Anybody ever notice or know somebody like that? I believe nowadays they call them Karens. If your name is Karen, it's not you specifically, so I apologize. But I believe they call them Karens. They used to be called Debbie Downers. They used to be called Gloomy Gusses, which I never heard of Gloomy Gus until recently. Eeyore, you know, and Eeyore, the Winnie the Pooh series. Oh, woe is me. I'm not happy. I have no joy. So guess what? You can't have joy either. It's one of those. Let's watch that last scene. You know, there's a line in that scene where the Grinch's heart starts to grow, and I love it. In desperation, he yells, "Help me, I'm feeling. Help me, I'm feeling." Why? Because in that moment, the Grinch is experiencing something he had never experienced before. You might say, well, Pastor Josh, what is that? His heart was coming alive. He was coming alive. He was starting to have those emotions of joy. He was starting to have those feeling moments. And you know, I can't help but think about some of you and watching that clip and thinking about some of you over the past 8 months that we've been here and the conversations that I've had with some of you guys and some of the people that I've known in ministry over throughout the years at our other church that we were at, and just people in general that we've seen God do some incredible things in your life. We've seen him do some things. And for some of you, you might have been the last person that you expected God to do that to, huh? If we're being truthful, you might have been the last person that you expected that to happen to. I remember conversations this year and in years past with some who said that they had no interest in God, no interest whatsoever, or someone who might have told me that they were just coming to check off the boxes, coming to church to check them off, coming to appease a family member. But over time, God began to change your heart. God began to change what was going on the inside. And you began to experience the love of Jesus in a way that you've never felt before. That's the way that God works. You started to feel again. You started to have that joy again. You see, the Bible tells us that we are all kind of similar to the Grinch because we have sin in our heart. Psalms 51:5 says, "For I was born a sinner, yes, from the moment my mother conceived me." And so we go on living our lives, doing the best we can. But trying to live without the love of God in our hearts is impossible. I promise you it's impossible. Through an encounter of a friend that comes to church, or a tragedy, or any number of life circumstances, maybe one day you find yourself feeling like you've never felt before. And then all of a sudden, you're unsure of how to even explain it. You find yourself feeling a need for God in your life. The Holy Spirit's drawing you back to him. And it's in that moment when we commit our life to Jesus that our heart comes alive like the Grinch. Our heart starts to feel again, and we experience true love for the very first time. But notice the Grinch today. Notice how he came to this turning point that we just watched. How did he do it? Notice how he did it. He did it by watching others who had true joy in their life. He was watching them. He was watching the Whoville and the people that had real joy. They didn't care about him stealing Christmas. They didn't care about anything else. They cared about each other, and they cared about loving and being together in unity. They had real joy. You see, the Grinch was sure by taking all of the gifts that they had that his plan would work, but he underestimated the power of hope. He underestimated the power of joy, and he underestimated the power of love. That's why, as followers of Jesus Christ, the life that we live is so important to the outside world. The life that you and I portray, not just for us, but for those who are watching you, because people watch you. I've heard stories about some of you that are good, and I've heard stories about some of you that are bad. My point is, people watch. My kids, I think I might have shared this before, but the one day Rachel was in a store, so this is years ago, and you know, I'm frustrated. I wanted to get going. I wasn't too joyful in my time in the car. She was taking a little bit longer than I had hoped for, and so without realizing, these little eyes were in the back seat watching. I'm like, oh, come on, Rachel, this is ridiculous. And so I'm talking and talking and talking, running my mouth, and she gets in the car, and I'm like, you ready? Yeah, that's all I say to her. And I think it was either Jace or Austin, one of those. I don't remember which one, but I think it was Jace, because he usually is the one that gets me in trouble the most. But But I'm pretty sure he said, oh, come on, Rachel, this is ridiculous, as she walked in the car or got in the seat. And she looked at me like, oh, so you've been talking about me, huh? I don't know where he got that from. But my point is, kids watch. Kids are like sponges. And sometimes when we're not joyful, and sometimes when we treat others not too good, kids see it. People see it. If you claim to be a Christian and a follower of Jesus Christ and a member of Grace Point community, I pray that you exude joy all over your life when you're outside of this church. I pray that people see you in a different way, and they, just like the Grinch, they're like, wow, something's different. I could try to steal all their joy, but nothing's going to steal their joy. Something's different, and I got to find out what that is. In closing, and if the worship team wants to come, all of that also happened with the Grinch. And it started with a little girl, Cindy Lou Who. Started with the little girl, Cindy Lou Who. You see, when it would have been easier for Cindy to stay away from him, she believed that there's something good in everyone. Even if it didn't look that way on the outside to her, she believed that there was something good in everyone. And it was through her grace, it was through the presence of Cindy in the Grinch's life, that his heart began to change. His heart began to change, and it started to do something different that he'd never felt before. I would be willing to wager, and I would be willing to bet, at some point in your life, you had a Cindy Lou Who in your life too. Someone that you looked up to, someone that you said, wow, I respect that person. They got all this stuff going on in their life, but yet they still find joy. You see, almost all of us can look back on our life-changing experience with God and identify someone who was significant in that conversation. You've met one of mine. Pastor Duncan's been here. He's one of those Cindy Lou Who's to me. There's many others, not just him. But who was it for you? Who was that person? You see, Jesus knew how powerful a life filled with real joy, with real hope, with real love could be. He said in Matthew chapter 5, "You are the light of the world, like a city on a hilltop that cannot be hidden." Here's what I'm convinced of. You and I have people in our life who are convinced that maybe... we are convinced that maybe they are mean, maybe they're violent, immoral, maybe they're not worthy, and that they're just a lost cause. Why? Because we've been trying for a long time. But what if they are those things, and what if they are like that because of their past or they've been hurt? I said it before in this message, hurt people hurt people. So what if that's them? And what if the only thing that is standing in their way of a new heart, a new life with God, is you? You might say, well, how is it me? It's your investment into their life. It's you speaking an encouraging word to them. It's you showing them the joy in your life that can be found. Just like Cindy's experience, I'm not going to say it's going to be easy, because it wasn't easy for her to do what she did for the Grinch. But what if your presence or your investment over time allows someone to see real hope, real joy, real love, possibly what it looks like for the very first time in their life? What if it's you? What if it's me? What if today we committed to be on the lookout for the people in the margins, for the people on the outside, for the hurting, the lost, the broken, the left out, the different than us, or even the disruptive? What if it's us? And what if we decided to let our life be like the light that Jesus talked about in the darkness? To let our light shine among the hills. When the church becomes a community of people who show real hope, real joy, real love. And they welcome those on the outside looking in. There is no heart that God cannot change. There is no heart that God cannot change. I hope that you'll be that light this Christmas season. I hope that you'll be that light today. And I hope that our mission this past year lets us seek people, lets us love people, and lets us share the story of the gospel, the story of Jesus, the story of how he can change even the hardest hearts. Amen. Let's stand and let's pray. If you're here this morning and you're being honest with me and you just say, Pastor Josh, for whatever the reason is, whatever the circumstance is, I just don't feel joyful this Christmas. I don't feel like there's hope this Christmas for me. If that's you, I'm going to ask you to do something hard right now. I'm going to ask you to just step out from your seats, come up here, and I want to pray for you, and there's going to be others that will pray for you. But just like that scripture tells us to cast all our cares upon the Lord, he cares for you. He cares for what you're going through. He cares for what your family's going through. So I encourage you as they do this song, as they sing this last song and we get ready to pray, I encourage you to bring it up here to the altar. Let's pray together. But if that's you, I want you to come now. If you do not have that joy that you've been hoping for, or you're asking God, you're like, God, please give me that hope. All it takes is that step. And if you don't feel comfortable coming by yourself, grab your neighbor. Grab your neighbor, grab your row. But come now, because this Christmas can be the Christmas that your life starts to change, that you start to have feeling in your heart once again. Amen? So right now, would you come? Go ahead and sing. as Kelly comes up to close. Let's remember in prayer, Loie had mentioned Kathy. Kathy's in the hospital, so we could remember Kathy in our prayers this week. Just pray that God intervenes and God heals with her situation. Give an encouraging word this week. Give a smile. Even if you're missing all your teeth, it's fine. I'm missing, I got a chipped tooth, so it looks funny, but you know what? You never know when your smile can change somebody's situation. So go ahead and do that, and let's pray. Father God, thank you, God, for what you're doing. God, we thank you that you came down to this earth for us, Father. We thank you that you have given us the true joy, that we don't have to search anywhere else, God, to find joy, to find peace, to find hope, God. It's only through Jesus. And Father, I pray as we get ready to close up this service that this week you will give us opportunities, God, to be that light on the hill to somebody, to be the light to somebody that's hurting, to be the light to somebody that's struggling, God. And I pray, Father, that we don't run from that. We run to it, God. We run to that challenge, Father. And that we encourage someone else. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. I said to someone a week or two ago, being happy doesn't cost you anything. It costs our salvation, cost our Lord and Savior his life on the cross. He gave us everything so we can have that joy, that peace, that love, that happiness that we can share with everyone. So remember that the joy of the Lord gives us strength to carry out his mission. And as we go through our week, as Pastor said, you know, smile, show, let it shine, let his light shine so all can see. Lord, I just thank you so much for the greatest gift that you ever gave us, which is salvation, that creates so much joy,